welcome to the John 3:30 podcast. He must increase, I must decrease, is the message John 3:30 invites us to live. Incorporating this into our everyday lives can be a challenge. What keeps your fire burning? We have many wonderful ways to stay close to our faith, whether it be the Mass, spiritual readings, prayer, adoration, or the rosary. This is Catholic Faith Life, and here's our host, Jason Nunez.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the John 3:30 podcast. This is your host, Jason Nunez, and welcome to episode number 60. I have a very special guest today. I'm Mr. Steve Picorni. How are you, Steve?
I'm doing great. It's great to be here, Jason.
Awesome. I got that right, didn't I?
You did. Yes. Nailed it.
Nailed it. Picorni.
Awesome. Nailed it.
So happy that I got that. I got that right. Awesome. Before we get going with our episode, we're going to go ahead and begin this episode the way we begin all of our episodes, and that is in prayer. Here we go. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come, Holy Spirit, come. O Jesus, meek and humble of heart, hear me. From the desire of being esteemed, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being loved, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being extolled, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being honored, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being praised, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being preferred to others, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being consulted, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being approved, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being humiliated, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being despised, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of suffering rebukes, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being calumniated, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being forgotten, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being ridiculed,
deliver me, Jesus.
From the fear of being wronged, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being suspected,
deliver me, Jesus.
That others may be loved more than I, Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. That others may be esteemed more than I, Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. That in the opinion of the world, others may increase and I may decrease, Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. That others may be chosen and I set aside, Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. That others may be praised and I unnoticed, Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. That others may be preferred to me in everything, Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. That others may become holier than I, provided that I may become as holy as I should. Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Alrighty, Steve, thank you very much. Go ahead and do us all a favor and tell us a little bit about yourself, please.
Sure. Thanks, Jason, again for having me here. And I am a husband and a father. That's the primary thing I want people to know at the time of this podcast. I've been 9 years married and have two daughters on earth and one in heaven from a miscarriage. And sounds like God needed another intercessor for our family. Professionally, I'm the founder of Freedom Coaching. It's founded freedom-coaching.net, where we are working to set the blind free from the darkness of the pornified culture. And so several aspects go into that, where I work with those one-on-one, both men and women, both Catholics, non-Catholics, but through a very Catholic lens, to break the attraction to pornography. And so that we are able to transform those desires. And then also on a wider scale is we want to create a culture of beauty, whereas it's of my belief that, and belief of many, that we in the church have given up our rightful place as the patron of the arts. And so we need to bring forth the beauty. And like, that's why I love the work that you're doing, Jason, with basically, and remember, beauty doesn't have to be something extravagant. It's usually found in the very simple and sometimes and even in the mundane. So being able to see that in the simple way in which we live out our faith, there's beauty to be found there. But many of us are blind to that. So helping people do that, I work also in part of this this ministry is going out and speaking to youth, speaking to adults, speaking to in between there, just to communicate the message of the message, especially of mercy, that we are loved beyond anything that we do, and that we are called to first be loved so that we can go and love others in and through the body that God has given us to live. And so it's been it's a humbling experience that God has put me in this position here, because taking the issue of pornography again, this is something I was trapped in for over 12 years, and thinking this is going to be my issue, something I'm going to struggle with the rest of my life, and by the grace of God being set free from that and now being able to go forth and really free others has been it's a journey, and I think we're just getting warmed up. So I'm really thankful for the opportunity to be here today, share a little bit.
Well, indeed, and thank you, of course, for taking time out of your day. So, wow. So taking a step back and looking at the big picture here, your husband, your father, and not only that, but you're a mentor, you're an author, and you're the spiritual leader. And with the work that you're doing, you live it.
I try to.
Right.
Just ask my wife. I'm working on it.
Don't we all, right? How do you, Steve, how do you keep your fire burning for a Catholic faith? Because I can imagine within the scope and the lens that you are working with, and especially with fighting the good fight against pornography, you must be, and I forgive my French here, you must be pissing off the evil one. Because that's a lot of his work right there. How do you keep your fire burning for a Catholic faith? How does it not get mundane? And there must be peaks and valleys, but how do you keep going and doing it?
I'll give you a perfect example. Okay. To kind of lead into that. That's a fabulous question and very interesting. Yesterday, for years I've gotten into the habit of, and I say this most humbly, not to boast myself, but gotten in the habit of fasting. Okay. And if you don't pray during fasting, then as Matt Fred would call it, you know, that's dieting. So there's got to be prayer in that. So even this is just yesterday. I'm doing some fasting, and I'm getting more and more irritated. And I forgot I was fasting. You know, I'm just going along my day, and I'm doing some praying throughout the day, but just kind of getting a little more irritated. And then it hit me towards the afternoon. I'm like, and things were kind of just heavy, right? Because anybody who fasts, you are literally the only thing that connects us from the other side of eternity is our breath, right? And it's literally food is one of the things that keeps us sustained here besides just oxygen and liquids. And so it finally hit me, and I just had to take a step back and realize, whoa, like we're in the midst. I'm also in the midst of a lot of different projects with the work we're doing, preparing to do a 12-part series with Shalom Global, Shalom World TV. Yep. So there's a lot going on here. Yeah. And so I would first and foremost say like, this is a war. Even the fact that, when we got, my wife and I, we were dating, I warned her flat out that if we get together, like, you need to be aware, like, I know what's at stake with the work that God has given to me. He's given me so much grace, and the evil one doesn't like the work that we're doing sometimes. And so like Sirach 2 says, right, if you're going to serve the Lord, prepare yourself for trial. So I'm very conscious of the fact that this is a battle that we're in. And you're absolutely correct. The work that we're doing with pornography is very important, because yes, it's destroying so many things, affecting so many things in a negative light. But my primary battle is for my marriage and family, right? If I do really well, I speak very well, and I write amazing books, and everybody loves them. To you know, paraphrase St. Paul, you know, Romans 12. If I do not have, or Romans 13. If I do not have love, I have nothing. If I do not live my vocation to marriage and family life well, then I have nothing. And we should burn the ministry. Burn Freedom Coaching. Burn my any works that I write, like Redeemed Vision, because none of that really matters. Because God has given me first and foremost to do that. So in the midst of that, you know, how do I keep that? Obviously, one is an awareness, right? That every day I wake up, I go to war.
Yep.
Right. It's not the battles of against flesh and blood. Nobody is my enemy here. Even if somebody doesn't agree with perhaps the message that we're proclaiming here, But we're contending against the powers and principalities and those of darkness. And to realize I have nothing to fear because Christ has won that all, but does call me into that. So a big part of my own spirituality, that's obviously has communicated a great deal in my ministry, is that of mercy. So I will start my day 99 out of 100 times with a Divine Mercy chaplet. Just because knowing that I need that mercy, I need to first go into and receive that mercy and call upon mercy. Because I, as we've already established here on this podcast publicly, I'm not a perfect man. And, right?
You and I both, my friend.
Right. I know a lot of things, but I know that I need, it's only through, you know, the opening prayer that you have there. And by the way, it was a little heartwarming. I remember praying that for three years, every day straight. There's some blessings from the same Bridget, that little blue, the blue book, right?
Right.
So praying that and working my way through that was very powerful. And ironically, my last name means humble. It's humble in Polish and peace in Russian, so I'm a walking contradiction twice over.
There you go, twice over.
So knowing that I need to first call on God's mercy, to fall on mercy, that I cannot do anything unless I receive mercy. And then connected to that is entering into prayer and contemplation. Like I'm a big fan of the Jesus prayer, and I'm a Byzantine Catholic. Mm-hmm. So for those who are kind of unfamiliar, there's two lungs of the church, as St. John Paul the Great has talked about, how we are united with, you know, a lot of us are familiar with the Western church, the Roman church, and a very male-oriented church, okay, going out and doing things to go conquer the world for Christ, all very necessary. And then the Eastern church, the spirituality, is more of this receptivity, the more feminine side. Doesn't mean I'm any less than a man, but if we use that analogy, which is more than just an analogy, but in a reality, Christ the bridegroom coming to love his bride, I am first and foremost called to be loved. Like John 4:10 says, it's not that you love me, but that I have loved you first. That's Jesus speaking to us. That we first, in order before we do anything, we must receive. Cannot do anything without, we cannot give what we do not have, right? So that notion, especially, I love that notion of Eastern spirituality, of receptivity. So one of the ancient prayers I love praying that I've rediscovered in the past year or so has been the Jesus prayer, which is, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And I think from this perspective, we need to be careful with that prayer. And I say that it kind of sounds interesting, because if we put so much of focus that I'm a sinner and I'm bad, then kind of we're going to look down on ourselves. But it's really about this whole thing that I'm calling upon mercy so that I can show mercy to others. And it's through that great grace that we can accomplish miracles, what we're called to. So from that, I love to use that prayer through a breathing exercise. Lord Jesus Christ, I breathe in, Son of the living God, breathe out, have mercy on me, breathe in, a sinner, breathe out.
Okay.
And I'll do that about a short period of time and do that about three or four times. And it really centers me, puts me in a good place. I'm actually wearing around my wrist right now. It's called a tchotchke. Okay. It's you know, look it up. My daughter's actually destroyed there's a tassel on it. Within like the first 15 seconds of receiving this gift, they destroyed it. Gone. So, it's a tchotchke without the tassel. So don't ask, you know, can I just touch the tassel on his cloak? It ain't happening here.
No.
So within this whole thing, that whole prayer is 100 Jesus prayers. That's what that prayer is. And this idea of that meditation and contemplation, entering deeper and deeper into the mystery of Christ. And when we do this, allows him the freedom to do what he wants with us. Right? So you have that. You want to keep going with some of the prayers that I do?
By all means.
Does that sound good?
Yes.
Okay. So
actually, before we get going here, you've touched on a topic there that I don't really think we have we've talked about before. So whenever that happens, I always like to ask the person that brings it up if they could kind of give a Cliff Notes 101 version, even though it may be kind of obvious. But
sure.
You mentioned that you've been fasting. Can you kind of give us, for those listening that may have an idea what it is, but want to know not only A, for sure what it is, but B, the reason behind it?
Sure.
If you can just kind of address that, I would greatly appreciate
sure.
it.
Sure. On a natural, basic human level,
right?
Fasting is really good for us. Okay, like helps to get toxins out of our bodies, helps with curbing appetites in mm-hmm. a certain sense. But on a deeper level, and remember when we say, I'm very hesitant in many circles to use the term spiritual. Okay, mm-hmm. on a spiritual side, because many of us think spirit good, body bad, and we have to say the goal of our lives is not to be more spiritual, but to be more incarnational, to live our spirit in and through our body. This is what Christ came to do. He came to integrate us. Original mm-hmm. sin has disintegrated us, so we need to integrate this. So one of the quickest ways to becoming integrated, especially in the pursuit of our true desires, is the practice of fasting. And so fasting is where we give up something good, which is food, for something better. Because I think a lot of us, like when we stop eating for a period of time, what happens? Duh, we feel hungry.
Right.
Okay. But don't stop there, because I think a lot of us just stop there and then we try to look for what food's here. Instead, we start, I challenge people to turn, what is that hunger pointing to? What's the deeper hunger that we're really looking for? Because at the end of the day, it's not more food that we're looking for. Like, think about anybody. We live in San Antonio, right? One right. of the most obese cities in the U.S. And that obesity, yes, there's a physical problem, but I think there's a deeper spiritual underlying root problem here, okay? Mm-hmm. And if we look at this, what is the deepest desire that we're all looking for? We are looking at somebody has said the four deepest desires of the human heart: to love and be loved, to see and be seen by another's loving gaze. Right? Many of us in our world feel very alone. We feel as though we are not accepted for who we are. We don't fit in. We come especially from broken families and relationships. Maybe we are coming from a broken marriage where what we hoped was going to be the fulfillment of life turned out to be the complete opposite of that. And thus we become very jaded against this. And so we close our hearts to what we think can actually, we close our hearts to any possibility there, right? And so what fasting, I would say another thing here is it gets us in touch with what our true desires really are. And if we will stay the pattern, if we'll stay the course and press into that pain, starting with that physical pain, we can press deeper into what is the deeper spiritual pain, right? And here's the secret of the ages, is that Christ wants to meet us there. Mm-hmm. Too many of us, and I've been there myself, too many of us are terrified to let him love us, to let him come into there, to make his place there, right? Is it like John 15 talks about, right? You are the vine, I am the vine, you are the branches, that I want to make my home with you, I want to become one with you, right? He longs for that, that whole Eucharistic prayer that he prays from John 13, we're on John 3:30 podcast, right? Go a little further, 13 through 17, that whole thing, and we really see Jesus' heart here. And so getting that process of fasting, like giving up that, and then also entering in when we feel that pain, entering in, not just saying words, not just saying our Father, Hail Mary, a glory be, but really what is the deepest ache of our heart and praying from that pain and saying, I unite my own pain to the great pains that you have in the cross. And then what happens is we become what we can call a spiritual rock star, okay? An incarnational rock star, whereas our pains and aches begin to fulfill what First Colossians 1:24 talks about. It, okay, mm-hmm. It says we make up what is lacking in the sufferings of Christ. And we might think that's a crazy statement. Didn't Jesus do it all? Well, yes, but no, because the thing he doesn't have is our sufferings. Because it's through his sufferings. The world's redeemed, right? Mm-hmm. And he wants us because we are bride. We are in this. We are united in a marriage with him. Whether we acknowledge this or not, we're meant to be here and to share and participate in the sufferings of Christ. And this allows for the redemption of the world right here and now. So, and this is a big thing, right? I've got a friend right now who's just had surgery for his kidney stones. Mm-hmm. Okay. Successful surgery. Praise God. His name's John. You can pray for him. But tremendous amount of pain he's going through.
I bet.
But he's very Catholic and he's like, this is unbearable, really hard. And so really encourage him, offer this up. Right. And this is the whole, we as Catholics, we're big on offer this up and let's find more things to beat ourselves up with. No, it's the normal things in life we find out. So in fasting, though, we make that little sacrifice so that we can open ourselves up to be more aware to the greater sufferings of others. Not to say that Jesus wants us to suffer, but if we allow ourselves to enter into those things, we are then transformed, which can also help to put our passions, okay, the passions for food, for entertainment, for sex, for all those things, put them in the appropriate order, and then we are able to, in the mystery of the economy of salvation, God is able to use that for his greater good. And then you combine that, you know, with our Lady, right? Giving that also over to our Lady, who takes our little prayers, our little sacrifices, and multiplies it beyond what we can imagine. And I think hopefully we'll know those stories. I have a belief we're going to know the ins and outs, all those stories and those sacrifices that we do, multiply to people who really are in need of this, who really are hungry beyond just mere physical food, and to illumine them to grace so they can say yes to grace.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you for that explanation there. That let's go ahead and continue on with what works for you.
Sure.
So in the morning you begin with the Divine Mercy.
Yeah.
And you also fast. So continuing on, like, say, throughout your day.
Mm-hmm. Throughout my day. Again, we're Byzantine Catholic, but I grew up Roman. So at times, my things will kind of ebb and flow. Mm-hmm. Whenever I can, we'll go to daily mass, right? Mm-hmm. I have the privilege of, I'm an entrepreneur of many sorts. Freedom coaching be a big part of that. And so having some of the time freedom to be able to go to it doesn't make me any better than anyone else. But I find that especially with the work we're doing, if this at the end of the day, this is a war and we are taking enemy territory and I'm commanded to, okay? And I make no bones about it. I'm a general in this and I'm called to help to raise up others who will be able to begin seeing as God has commanded them to see so we can bring freedom of vision and freedom of purity of heart. And so I've got to, again, I can't give what I don't have. Mm-hmm. So going to Jesus, receiving the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus Christ, liquid love poured out for us, as Father Don Calloway would say here, right? This need, this great need, again, going back to this, the hunger, right? That deeper hunger that I have, that first and foremost, I need to tap into what is the deep desire that's in me so that I can, with empathy, tap into the desires of others, right? And it's in the Eucharist, right? We are connected to others, and Christ makes that will known to me. So I like to say, you know, if we're using military terms, it's at Mass I get my marching orders.
Marching orders.
Right? Mm-hmm. I go in, I go to get fed, so then I can launch. And I go out and live my day. And that's why I like to go to Mass earlier. It doesn't matter when we go necessarily, but it's that we go and we enter in with totality. So very frequently getting to do that. At times, being a husband and father, my youngest daughter is finally going to kindergarten. But hasn't
all right.
For a
thanks
long,
be to God.
Thanks be to God. It hadn't happened for a while. So like I would watch her during part of the day. My wife has always worked, has also worked, not always. But so I take her to Mass with me. So that opportunity to be able the bond there and an or two there. And for a five-year-old, she's done pretty well. I'll say that. And so throughout that day, and then bringing in the Angelus, right? Angelus at times
noon.
Throughout the day there, praying as a family, right? We will sometimes bring in morning prayer there. And again, there's the Liturgy of the Hours. There's also that of the Byzantine tradition has also a different time type of morning prayer. And then obviously, as we get through my day, I just know because I do a lot of work with clients, right? And this is heavy lifting at times. I mean, we get into a lot of the darkness of clients, and not so much focused on or not so much interested on the darkness, but seeing what the emotional roots there. That's a major part of the work, and then helping them to reconnect their head and heart, a way in which they've never really processed those things in those way. And so getting into that, It's ugly, right? And what I want most is beauty. So I know that I need to fall on my knees, and so I've got an image of image of the divine mercy. And so I'll fall on my knees, look at that, take time to look, just right. simply look, let him look back at me and speak non-verbally to me. So that, and again, it's about recentering there, because if for a moment I think that this is quote unquote my ministry, or that, this is all in my power, it's when I'm in deep trouble, if not dead.
Yes. Cause it's not exactly that's, we do need to realize that it's not our power, and it's us physically doing it. Like, it's my body, it's yeah. my voice saying these words, but it's not coming from me, right? So that's really important and powerful that you definitely mentioned that, and I'm definitely happy to hear that you know that's being said. And sitting and looking at the image of the Divine Mercy, that in itself can be a prayer. Oh, just yeah. simply sitting and looking at it, and intently and wholeheartedly and sincerely looking at it. That in itself can be a prayer.
Well, and even so, I mean, one of the things I love about our Eastern tradition is that of iconography, right? For those who aren't familiar, an icon is not a picture, okay?
Right.
So just like the Word of God is the written, oh, the Bible, for instance, is the written Word of God, icons are the visual Word of God. And so an iconographer does not draw an icon. They write an icon, mm-hmm. okay, through inspiration of the Holy Spirit entering in. Just like the writers of the sacred scriptures, they wrote the scriptures. They are writing these icons. And so when using iconography, right, I look at that image, the image looks at me, and I'm not trying to, or I even say, I look the image. There's a difference between looking at something and looking. What's the difference? Looking at something is kind of, I'm bringing my own me into it, my own stuff, mm-hmm. and kind of interpretation there. To look an image, because it doesn't translate well in English, to look an image mm-hmm. is to allow the image to speak. And a lot, and it's same thing like when we encounter another person, when we're having communication with somebody, or we're having a conversation, are we allowing that person to speak, or are we ready with our response while they're talking, or do we allow them fully to express themselves, allow for a pause in the conversation, and then respond to the fullness of what they're saying, both verbal and nonverbal cues? And I think like we're here in person in studio.
Yeah.
And it's a great thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
So within this whole thing of iconography, you know, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, these iconographers have communicated this. And so able to use these images to enter deeper into the mystery of Christ, right? And there's tons of images, and this is one of the things, like in the work, Redeemed Vision, Setting the Blind Free from the Pornified Culture. This is the book that I've been working on for 14 years, and
yep.
thank God for my wife, my midwife, as I expressed to you, Jason, beforehand was that of, she helped to really edit this thing to death. editing a work is a hard, hard thing.
Attention to detail is putting it lightly, I would imagine.
And it's also a humbling thing for an author, because you have Stephen King actually uses the phrase, you have to kill the darlings. It's mm-hmm. where you have these great phrases, they're so wonderful. He's like, those are the ones you have to kill. You got to surrender them.
Yep.
And so the same thing. So that's what an editor does. So in a major thing that we speak about in Redeemed Vision is this use of artwork, this use of iconography, this use of images, that we use beauty so that we can have our vision transformed here. So that we, in here, if we're longing for love, we're also directly connected to that is longing for beauty. And so this is one of the things throughout my day, right? Trying to bring beauty in through the day. Because, you know, you go to like Drudge Report or CNN or whatever, MSN. It's an ugly world that's trying to be painted out there.
Yeah.
So, but there is a lot of beauty to be found, Jason. And so I want to keep that going in our family. And then the last thing to sum up, like, especially the end of the day, right? Because parents, I think we struggle. We're the primary education in the faith. But how do we communicate that to our kids? And I like to just keep it simple. So sometimes we'll pray a part of a rosary, like, because sometimes, you know, they're small kids necessarily. I do believe in the family rosary. I think there's a huge power to the rosary. But we'll also sometimes, we just want to do it real simple. So really ask him, along with an Our Father, Hail Mary, Glory Be, ask him three questions, right? What are you grateful for? Mm-hmm. What could you have done better? And who needs our prayers? Right. So that simple way, first, we ask for gratitude, right? So we acknowledge the giver of all good gifts. Mm-hmm. Second, what are the ways we have not lived up to the goodness that we are and the goodness he calls us to? And then third, how can I make a gift of myself by offering up prayers for someone who really needs it?
Beautiful. That's a great way to kind of end your day as a family. And in a way, it's kind of a nice short way of almost examining your day and your conscience at the level for a child, which is very hard to approach that topic with a child. A, because your uphill battle is their attention span. And they're not going to remember 5 minutes ago you want them to examine their whole day, right?
Yeah.
So with those three questions, you're laying it out very, very nicely in a simple way for them to, you know, do that.
Absolutely. That's awesome. I think that's a crucial part. And I ebb and flow with the examination of conscience. I need to do more of it, I think. So thanks for calling me out. But I love Matthew Kelly's The Prayer Process. Mm-hmm. It's a glorified form of that. I teach clients to use that. And in times, I'll come back to that and use it. I think it's very powerful within about 7 minutes, because there's 7 points. Mm-hmm. We're able to use that to enter deeper. What is Christ calling me to in this simple way?
Beautiful, beautiful. Speak to us a little bit more about Redeemed Vision, about your book.
Sure. So it's a two-part project, and I mentioned there. First is a lot of people are looking for answers, right? We're looking for answers on this issue of pornography, on good evidence. I was talking to a priest yesterday, actually, and he's talking to one. He didn't give any names or specific details, but just in general, and he's talking about this one penitent who's just been struggling with this for a long time, and he's also very nervous about this. He had actually floated the idea of coming to work with Freedom Coaching, and the guy's just getting terrified, getting really nervous. Oh my gosh, something new. And this priest, he just says to me, if you only knew, this is 95% of my penitence.
Wow.
Okay. And Father Thomas Loya, who's a Byzantine priest up in Homer Glen, Illinois, of Annunciation Mother of God community. He says that, and this is hard for us to take, but sadly it's true. In many cases, look across the parish pews, we're guilty before being innocent in this issue. Like most guys have had an issue with pornography,
right?
Okay, and what's the reason for that? Let's dig into that just very briefly here. So the reason is we've never had anything. This has been the first experience for most of us, our encounter of the body. Okay, so let me give you an example. Let me give a counterpoint. Talk about this in the book. 9-year-old boy is at a park with his family. True story. I a friend of mine was doing research on this, and every time it was the same. Came across pornified images. That's how they got to a Playboy magazine. Blah blah blah. Well, every single one was the same except for one. It was a 9-year-old boy was at a park with his family for picnic and came across a pornified image, an image of a gentleman's club with two topless women. He immediately goes to his elder sister and says, "I found a yucky picture." The older sister says, "Go talk to your older brother about this." Older brother says, "Okay, show it to me." He does. The younger brother brings him to that image, and the older brother takes it, immediately rips it up, throws it away, and says, "You don't need to be looking at that." This presupposes two questions, Jason, and I'm going to put you on the spot, right?
Alrighty.
Because you're putting me on here. So hot seat coming. So number one is, how did that little boy immediately go and tell his sister? And two, how did that older brother immediately rip that up and throw it away?
Well, I would think that the younger boy went to his sister because he saw women on the picture. So, and he went and showed a female that he's comfortable showing this to.
Okay.
And honestly, why the older brother would rip up the picture, I don't know. I'm probably putting my brothers on the spot there because my brothers probably wouldn't have done that.
What would they have done?
They would have showed me the picture.
Okay, right. Maybe. But a vast majority of, especially guys.
Sorry, Joe.
A vast majority of guys, we find that image. What do we do with it?
We hide it.
We do. Mm-hmm. Why?
Because we want to look at it later.
We look at this like buried
treasure. Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. Oh, my gosh. Mm-hmm. I have just won the lottery. Mm-hmm. Why is this, Jason? And I'll answer it for us because I want to keep our time, keep going here. Mm-hmm. It's because this is our first exposure to the body. We have normalized pornified images in our culture. And sadly, and this goes along with the larger project of this work, and that's why I'm saying this is not just a work for those who are involved with pornography. This is for, especially for Catholics. I want to go after Catholics because we get our spot, our place in order, or just take the Matthew Kelly numbers, get 8% of Catholics living their faith, which I love what you're doing, Jason. We took over the world. So it's about helping to establish a culture of beauty, but inadvertently, many parents are actually creating the environment for pornography to flourish.
They are.
How can I make that statement here? I mean not to condemn any parents, but we do need to be aware. Why? Because there's never been a healthy, holistic, honest education about the human body. Because many times, and part of the work that we want to do is challenge the presuppositions we have about the body. As I mentioned earlier, for a lot of us, we got this notion, body bad, spirit good, right? Mm-hmm. And we communicate this either non-verbally or verbally. Take the issue of when, another girl dressed and doesn't approve of it, or maybe it's quote unquote immodest, and we got to be very careful with that phraseology because it's not just about the level of clothing somebody's wearing. We might look down on her, or they start to look down on themselves. Right. Like, oh, I don't like this body part, or I have wrinkles or love handles. Mm-hmm. And there's this huge culture of body shaming that's going on. Yes. And if a mother is conveying this, and obviously a father can do the same way with the way in which he treats his wife, the way he looks at his wife, this communicates volumes to their kids.
Right.
And never having a healthy, holistic understanding, and even, let me be very frank, a healthy understanding of the naked human body, to see the body appropriately so. It's not about gawking, but seeing the body appropriately so within the lived experience of the family, right? In ordinary circumstances, like shower or bathroom, right? Grand potty, right?
Right.
We're not showing off, but just those ordinary lived experiences. Instead, in many cases, there's this fear, culture of fear, this culture of suspicion. And it has to do with the fact is most of us, we have this notion, four things we've lumped together. We've equated attraction, nakedness, the body, and lust all in one thing. And sex. But that is it. Nakedness, attraction, sex, and lust all in one lump.
One.
The problem is not nakedness. The problem is not attraction. The problem is not not the body or sex. The problem is lust.
Right.
The problem is that we have this brokenness and a tendency to want to use others. Right? But here's the kicker. What did Jesus come to do? Jesus came to set us free now. Came to set us free to that concupiscence is a reality. For those who don't know, right, original sin is real. It is what it keeps us from eternal life, right? Baptism washes away baptism, but we're left with concupiscence. What is that? The tendency to be selfish. Most Catholics, especially regarding our sexual desire, still think that concupiscence has the final word on this. That I could never see a woman, regardless of how she's dressed, and see her as a person. And we, especially as Catholics, should say, that's a lie, and call that out. The liar does not have sway over my heart here. And I'm going to claim redemption to be able to see that person, regardless of how they're dressed, as a human being. But if we have not been trained in this from our earliest days, and pornography is presented to us, because let's be very frank, there is something beautiful in pornography. There is something good there. Why? There's a person there. Even if there's airbrushing, right? Mm-hmm. We are called to enter into seeing other people as persons. We desire love. We desire beauty. So there's a semblance there that's been twisted.
And that person is someone's daughter, yeah, mother, sister, brother, son. It's weird because like, I was starting to have this conversation with my wife the other day, but if we didn't continue, I forgot why, but we didn't. But I, whenever I hear of something bad happening to someone or someone is bad, like if you look at someone and they're a murderer or they're just a bad person. When I look at them, I think I've had this thought to myself. Somewhere in some household, there is a elementary school picture of them with a shirt on of a cartoon character or of them in pigtails.
Yeah.
And that's...
Or big glasses or braces.
Exactly. Exactly. And that was them. And they're here now. This. What happened from that moment in time of that picture to where they are now?
Yeah.
And the same thing. The same thing when you're looking at pornography is, you know, what happened from them being this sweet, innocent person to what's happening now? Like, and that's happening to a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
It's scary and it's sad, but it's a big question to ask, right? Like, between that in that picture that I have in my mind of someone of in someone's grandma's house, there's a picture of a frame of them in just an innocent picture of them, and now they're doing this or they're posing for this or they're committing this act or this crime. How many? What started that line of lies that they bought that got them to that point?
Mm. Good question, isn't it?
Yes.
I mean, obviously, first and foremost, it's a lack of belief in our own goodness. And somewhere along the line, it's been communicated to us. And so as children, those feelings become eroticized. And sadly, because of our pornified culture, so many things in our media, and I want to make it very clear, technology is a good. Right
it
now,
is.
We're using technology in a very, I believe, I hope, right? Hopefully this isn't a half-bad podcast.
hopefully, yeah.
So, or episode, I should say.
Right.
Then we can use it for great good. But sadly, because we haven't been formed in beauty in many cases, we are not... we have a tendency to want to corrupt that. We follow the fallenness of concupiscence, right? And we end up using people in and through different mediums, right? If you want to get life right, love people, use things. But that tendency, typically, we reverse it, and that's how we get ourselves into trouble.
Right.
And so from here, those persons, right, are never learned their own goodness, their own beauty, the beauty of their body, that they're called to be a gift. They violate the law of the gift, which is means to the degree that we are gifts to others and seeing ourselves a gift is the degree in which we will find fulfillment and joy in life. Okay? So that's really what we should be communicating to our kids. But many of us have never learned this. It's all about us. The me, mine, more attitude of the pornified culture. And then what happens is those feelings again flip. They become eroticized. And many times they're much earlier than before. I mean, I know a 5-year-old boy has been into pornography. I've mentored 8-year-olds in this.
Wow.
Okay? I mean, the average age of exposure is between 8 and 11 years of age. So, and when those feelings can become eroticized, if there hasn't been the appropriate context and there hasn't been anything to counterimpose or shall we compare to pornified images, they're gonna think pornified images is what I should be pursuing.
And then it's normal.
And we've normalized pornography.
We've become numb to it.
Yep. And most parents have created this environment for it.
Right.
So, and then we get into whole good, and I put this in quotes, good holy Catholic circles who then teach the notion that covering the body solves all the problems. We say, not necessarily, right? There are those who can be completely covered in their body, but with their actions can be very lustful. And so, but you can also have somebody, you know, a woman giving birth, not a stitch of clothing, totally modest, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so it's not about that language there. So when a person is seeking out pornography from very young to older, I mean, I work with those in their 70s, in fact. So this doesn't hold any bounds on time.
There's no age limit.
There's no age limit. It's we're looking for love. Those four deepest desires: to see and be seen, to love and be loved. And somewhere along the way, there's the notion this is lacking in me, or if we think we're lacking, even though because we're beloved sons and daughters, it's never lacking. We just have to claim it. We go down this road, which when you couple in all the chemicals of the brain praying, which, by the way, in Redeemed Vision, Setting the Blind Free from the Pornified Culture, chapter 3 especially, talking about the brain chemicals, we're not able to break free from this. And if you take one of the most powerful experiences that the brain can experience, that of an orgasm, sorry to be frank here, which is what masturbation is about here, this bonds to the brain, and it becomes very difficult, if not impossible, to say goodbye to this, because the tons of emotions here, and then you bring in dopamine, norepinephrine, oxytocin, things like this, those chemicals, it defeeds the brain. We've created a neural pathways that say, this is what you want. If you don't get this, you're going to die. And then you couple in here when we misuse our sexuality, right? Just like if you were to ignore the law of gravity and jump off a building without a parachute, you know, that law is going to come hard and fast.
Literally,
and you're going to get reality there. You go against the law of the gift, and the law of the gift, which is stamped right into the human body, that guilt and shame comes up. The guilt being, I've done a bad thing, and shame is, I'm a bad person. And there are so many countless people walking around right now with shame, and they don't know what to do about it. And so this projection that I'm a bad person is then projected onto others, that you're a bad person. You can't be good.
Right.
And we breed this culture of this atmosphere of negativity. It's what we're breathing. Right. So what's the way out? Well, first and foremost, we need to acknowledge we've got an issue with a lot of the types of media we're seeing, that the pornified culture, if we're directly into pornography, to realize this doesn't just go away. It will get worse if you do not deal with it. Second, we need to learn how to see. And we need to learn how to recover our sight to see the body correctly. And in the midst of that would be technically the second part, but we'll call it third here for our list, is that we're looking for love in all the wrong places, as the old country song goes. And I'll save your listeners from the song, my voice right now. In ultimate, that intimacy is found in Jesus Christ, who wants to reveal to us our own goodness, the goodness of our body, the goodness of our sexuality, the goodness of attraction, and to help to destroy lust, basically. That as 1 John 4:18, perfect love casts out all fear. And that if we will surrender these fears to the one who does not want to destroy us, but wants to bring us home so we can enter into union with him, we'll find freedom, which brings peace and hope.
Beautiful. And you mentioned that you worked with children and with 7-year-olds. So that's where freedom coaching comes into the picture. Is that correct?
Yes. I mean, obviously the freedom coaching is a process that has come out of my own woundedness. Mm-hmm. And this process is through various things that I've done, and then other things being added, being given to me by the Holy Spirit, mm-hmm. To be able to bring healing to others. So yeah, so working with both men and women, Catholics, non-Catholics, but ultimately, because the church has a wide, the church is the caretaker of the fullness of Jesus Christ, right? And the fullest caretaker of the answers that we're really looking for. Here, we need to realize that we are able to, that regardless of what a faith person has, is they're called to intimacy with Jesus Christ, called to enter into union in the church. Whether there's a conversion there, whatever. I leave that between Christ and that person.
Right.
But again, especially I want to help Catholics to live out the life they're called to, and to come forth like Lazarus. When Jesus says, Lazarus, come forth, I want to call them forth from the cave of shame.
Beautiful, beautiful. Steve, you're doing great work. And I'm honored, and I'm excited that you're here speaking about this, sharing your message, and I'm excited to see what's going to come from your work with Shalom Media. There, I've heard great things about them. Another friend of the podcast, Brian Mercier, who's a Catholic speaker on apologetics, gave some talks in Illinois, mm-hmm. and is going to be working with them as well. So they're doing a lot of great things, and they're getting a lot of great people on board, and I'm definitely excited to see what more comes from that project there.
Praise God.
Thank you again for everyone listening. The name name of the book is Redeemed Vision, Setting the Blind Free from the Pornified Culture, which is true, because unfortunately that is a world we're living in now. We all have a smartphone in our pocket. It is scary, the damage that can be done with that piece of technology in our hand. But it's beautiful to think of what could come from that technology.
This is how we connected. Well. They praise God for Instagram.
That's right. And kind of a funny side story on that is when we connected on Instagram, I was like, I'm in San Antonio. We could probably do this through Skype. And you're like, dude, I live in San Antonio too. No way. Like, who would have thought that we connected on social media and we lived in the same city?
Yep. So, never met before. So here we are.
Yeah, exactly. Never met before. First time ever. So aside from Redeemed Vision, which you can find on Amazon and anywhere fine books are sold, on Amazon, there's an ebook out there that was co-written with Steve's wife, Valerie. It's called Marriage, the Heavenly Banquet, 5 Practical Applications to See Your Marriage as the Sacrament, the Sacramental Blessing It Was Intended to Be. So that is another option that you can pick up on Amazon as well, as an ebook. You can look up Freedom Coaching. That is a one-on-one mentoring system aimed to helping those with an attraction to pornography reclaim a healthy vision of the body and of sexuality, and thus attain antidote to the enticement of pornography images.
And the other one I would add is if anybody's on Instagram, check out redeemed_vision, just like the title of the book. That's where you can follow me and follow the work we're doing. And again, this will continue to expand. And somewhere down the line, there will be other coaches for Freedom Coaching. And
beautiful.
So good things are coming.
Indeed. Before we get to our parting questions, I want to kind of touch on the cover of the book here of Redeemed Vision. Can you kind of speak a little bit about that cover? Because it's a beautiful image and it's pixelated.
Yeah.
And before you get into your why you pick this particular cover and the reason why, I don't know if you've gotten this comment before, and it's and I'm saying this with all due respect because I don't mean to make light of the subject matter of this book because it's very serious and it's true and it needs to be spoken about. But when I received your book, thank you, by the way, when I received the book and I saw the cover, one of my first images, and this is going to sound terrible, but it was Avengers Infinity War.
I love it. Do tell.
Okay.
I have not gotten this before.
Okay. Have you seen the movie yet?
I have.
Okay.
So, are we gonna spoil it?
It's been Umbada. That movie came.
It's a spoiler alert for anybody who's not seen it. Okay. Because you might be a parent and you have kids and you can't be out of the theater. Okay. Forever.
Let's put it this way. Okay. I know the movie came out in April because my son's birthday was in April and we went to the movie for his birthday. But at the end, this is not a spoiler. If you haven't seen it by now, too bad. At the end of Infinity
just
War.
Just pause the fast forward for 3 minutes.
There you go. So at the end of Infinity War, when the characters fade away, they pixel away into dust. And the image that you have on your book cover it's a beautiful image to the left. And as you're sweeping across to the right, it begins to pixel away and kind of dip down. That's the image of our superheroes fading away. They're pixeling away and then they go away into dust. So that's why when I saw your cover, I thought Avengers Infinity War.
I'm totally stealing this. This is beautiful for a talk coming up. This is great.
Okay,
love it.
Perfect.
I had never thought about this. So the image very quickly, and a friend of mine, Tobin Pilati, who's in he's in San Antonio, likes to come to the Oblate Renewal Center, likes to come to him from Mass. He's the one who kind of came up with this concept. He's loved this image for years. And the image is from Titian, The Sacred and the Profane. Okay, and so for those who, you know, maybe can pull up the image on, you can see the whole thing, the image. Yep. You can also look at my book. Amazon, and the original image is just breathtaking. You got on the left, you got a bride who's fully covered, even hands have gloves. On the right, you have Venus, and Venus is bare-breasted in here. Her loins are covered by a loose cloth, and she's holding an incense. Okay, and in the middle is Cupid, the cherub that brings people love, and the title of the painting again is Sacred, the Sacred and the Profane. And people on the initial thought, especially in the Western world, might think, okay, the woman who's clothed is the sacred, and the one who's bare breasted is being profane. But if you study this, is the exact opposite. Because the woman on the right, the bride, actually is trying to pretend this other woman doesn't exist. Her body language speaks
right.
that I do not want anything to do with this. And her whole clothing here is actually a profanation of the body, because it's saying I am the clothing I wear, right? And Scripture, I think it's 2 Timothy, talks about women do not wear such gaudy and audacious clothing, right? That's not who you are. That's what it's saying. And not to say that covering the body is good or bad, right? In a certain, it's depending on why are you doing what you're doing. So then on the flip side here, the Venus here is actually the modest one, but she's bare-breasted. Yes, but breasts are not the problem, right? It's how we're seeing those. God created breasts primarily for the woman, for who she is, then secondary for her children to nurse them. Mm-hmm. And we as men have become blinded to this notion. And if you look at her in this painting, she's simply being who she is. She's being absolutely normal, like a normal person would go to the bathroom or to go take a shower, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or bathe, right? It's she's normal. She's not showing off. It's not a pornified image here. And you also notice what's fascinating in the back behind the bride is a castle, speaking of the secular world. I don't know if you caught that. Mm-hmm. In the back behind Venus is the church. And Titian is speaking the language, the notion that it's the church that brings about the notion of what true beauty is and the meaning of the body. And then you bring in the pixelated notion here is that kind of sweeping away. I love what you've done with this, John, that kind of bring this explanation even more. Because of the pornified world, the digital media, has basically taken over the naked bodies, taken over the human body, we may fall into the notion thinking that that body is something that should be avoided instead of learning how to actually see the body. And so this is actually stealing the way in which the pornified culture is working, is stealing our capacity to receive and give beauty. And so we have to come back to a rediscovery and a new catechesis, a new education of who and what the body is, and enter into how to actually see, regardless of the clothing in the images that are displayed there.
Beautiful.
Hey guys, we're going to take a quick break here. I have a quick question for you all. Do you want to support the podcast? Well, you can. You can help the John 330 podcast by working with our sponsor. When you need to buy or sell a house anywhere in the country, even in Canada, please give Rob DeMaio a call. You may remember Rob from episode number 27 when he appeared with his wife Camille. He's an experienced, award-winning realtor and can help you find an exceptional agent at no cost to you. Think of him as your real estate matchmaker. Just call him, tell him your needs, and he'll connect you with exactly the right agent in his extensive network. You can call or text Rob at 210-488-1144. Again, that's 210-488-1144. Tell him you heard it right here on the podcast. Now, back to the show. Love it.
Praise God.
Indeed. We are going to get to our parting questions here, Steve. So here we go. Speaking of superheroes.
Booyah.
If you could have a superpower, what would it be?
I'll take the Catholic answer, the power to love perfectly, but in the whole fantasy way, I want to fly. I desire to fly more than anything, and so in heaven, I will be dive bombing people, and everybody will be laughing. I can't wait.
Can't wait.
No wings. I'm not an angel, and thank God I'm a human being.
There you go. Who is your favorite saint?
So that's a very tough question. Okay. So I ask the intercession, especially of St. John Paul the Great. I like St. Longinus, who was at the cross, who had the blood and water flowed. He was actually, it's believed he was partially blind or maybe more than that. And in having the blood and water, he learned, gained his sight.
Wow.
St. Lucy is patron saint of vision. Right, so I like asking for her intercession. But one who will be a saint is the caped crusader of Catholicism, Fulton Sheen.
Yes, he is my man.
If he's not a saint in our lifetime, then something went wrong seriously. But he, being a digital mogul, having the the highest rated show throughout the 1950s, beating out one of the highest, Milton Berle, highest comic during the time. And his teachings, like, go to YouTube if you haven't studied Folding Sheen. What he says then, back then, this is like 60 years ago, 70 years ago, are absolutely true right now. So even there's the complete Folding Sheen collection. So I ask for his intercession very frequently, and I believe that his intercession has been very powerful in my life.
Indeed. He's like on my all-star saint team.
Yep.
Even though he's venerable at the time of this recording, he's still on my all-star team.
Yep.
So
yep.
I love Fulton Sheen. So venerable Fulton Sheen, St. Lucy, St. Longinus, pray for us.
Longinus,
pray for us.
Pray for us.
If you could describe how you live your faith with a hashtag, what would it be?
#DayZero.
#DayZero.
Yes.
Okay.
So if anybody listening has been familiar with Alcoholics Anonymous, and I don't want to knock that program. There's many benefits to it, right? Community is very huge, acknowledging the issue. And somebody who stands up in AA, the typical thing will say, "Hi, my name is Steve, and I'm an alcoholic." And then the next thing out of their phrase is, "It's been 30 days since my last drink." Mm-hmm. Okay? If you look carefully, that second phrase they use, "It's been 30 days since my last drink," the focal point is on the disease, on the problem. And you focus on the problem long enough, you begin to identify that. We were talking about that before the podcast began.
You were.
Right. And if we identify ourselves that's who we are, then I am the problem. I am bad and nothing good can happen of it. And especially when taking any issue we're trying to overcome or take the issue of pornography, way too many people who are trying to battle against this are counting days. It's been 30 days since my last time I looked at pornography and masturbated. Instead, we want to say #DayZero. No counting. Why? Because redemption is real, Jason. Jesus Christ died for us now. His redemption is a reality, and we need to claim it. It doesn't mean what happened in the past didn't happen. We're not saying that. We're not saying it's not serious and doesn't need to be dealt with. No, we're saying right now we can claim redemption because our identity, we are a beloved son or daughter of the Most High who calls us into relationship, that we are not defined by our diseases and our brokenness. We are defined by the fact that we are loved and called to be loved infinitely. And so we're called to claim that regardless of if we're having a hard day. So yesterday doesn't matter in a certain sense, and tomorrow hasn't happened. Focus on right now, day zero, which means if we're on day zero, the whole world is open to us. There's a plenitude, an infinite amount of possibilities of what can happen here. So claim day zero for your own life so you can live the life that God has called you to live today.
Love it. That's good stuff. Lastly, what message do you want to leave our listeners with?
To quote John Paul the Great, 2012, or to paraphrase, right? We are not the sum total of our mistakes and failings. We are the sum total of our Father's love for us. You are more loved than you can possibly imagine. The guilt and shame that you may have in you is nothing compared to the love of where you come from, of what you are called to live in, and where you're going. And to paraphrase C.S. Lewis, writing in The Great Divorce, that lust is a weak, whimpering thing compared to desire set to full power, set to full flourishing. You are called to fly, my brothers and sisters. The question is, will you let him love you? Will you let him come in to have his place in you so that you can come alive? That's my hope and prayer for you today, that you will claim this. And if you will claim this and live your body out as a gift, that you will fulfill the very meaning of your being and existence.
Amen.
Amen.
Steve, thank you very much for taking time out of your day.
An honor,
and sharing with us what keeps your fire burning for our Catholic faith. Thank you so much.
Amen. An honor.
Indeed. In John 3:30, we do find that he must increase and must decrease. I want to give a special thanks to Victoria here at Oblate Renewal Center for allowing us to record this particular episode on Holy Ground. And want to give a special thanks to our executive producer for this episode is Dr. Jarvista. Thank you for your support of the podcast. If you like what you hear, you want to be a guest, by all means, send me an email. You can do so at john330podcast@gmail.com, or you can contact me on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram the way Steve did. And we can definitely communicate that way. You do not have to be local in the area. I can do interviews through Skype or through just a standard phone call. You can also find the John 330 podcast on Breadbox Media. We are a one-of-a-kind Catholic-based, spirituality-focused national podcast network. Breadbox Media has been endorsed by clergy across the country, including Archbishop Joseph Kurtz. He's in the Archdiocese of Louisville, Bishop Ronald Gainier in the Diocese of Harrisburg, Bishop Kevin Rhodes in Diocese of Fort Wayne, South Bend, and Cardinal Donald Ward, the Archbishop of Washington. Breadbox Media. We feature some of the biggest names in Catholic media, including Catholic Answers, Lisa Henley, Rod Bennett, John Michael Tablet, and of course the John 330 podcast. For these and a complete listing of 30 plus shows and expanding even more every day, you can go to breadboxmedia.com. Thanks again to our sponsor, Robin Camille DeMaio. And thank you everyone for listening. No matter how you listen, if you have a option to leave a review, please do so. That will greatly help me out. We're available on iTunes, Spotify, practically anywhere you can find podcasts. We're going to end this episode the way the Nunez family ends our time in Mass every time we attend. And that is by praying the intercessory prayer to St. Michael the Archangel. So here we go. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly hosts, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Steve, thanks again for your time.
An honor. Blessings, my brother.
Indeed. And everyone, thank you for listening. Have a good rest of your day. God bless you all.